Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Weavers, Scribes and Kings, A New History of the Ancient Near East by Amanda H. Podany, narrated by Amanda H. Podany. For my mother, Margaret Graham Hills, with love and thanks. Introduction. A few years ago, the world discovered Ea Natsir. An article by an archaeologist named Christina Kilgrove in Forbes magazine was titled Meet the Worst Businessman of the 18th Century BC. Kilgrove detailed the financial problems of a merchant, Ea Natsir, who lived in a big house in the city of Ur in what is now Iraq. She made a strong case for his ineptitude, quoting from letters that he had received from unhappy customers, people who were at their wits' end, trying to get him to send products they had been promised or refunds for goods he hadn't delivered. Kilgrove quoted one letter in full. It had been written by a man named Nani, and it reads like an angry diatribe to a complaints department. In the middle of his letter, Nani wrote, "Who am I that you are treating me in this manner, treating me with such contempt? I have written to you to receive my money, but you have neglected to return it." The remarkable thing about this frustrating case of incompetence is that both of the men involved have been dead for many thousands of years. Ea Natsir lived almost 3,800 years ago. Just think how long ago that is. It's hard to wrap your mind around. He lived 2,400 years before the time of Muhammad and the beginning of Islam, 1,300 years even before the founding of the Roman Republic. And yet, as the article showed, we recognize Ea Natsir. He's the vendor who fails to reply to our emails and phone calls. And any of us might have written Nani's letter. We just wouldn't write it in cuneiform script on a clay tablet. The article clearly resonated with readers, and it enjoyed a flurry of interest on social media. Any number of my friends and students sent it to me. Other posts about Ea Natsir appeared, and the long-dead merchant suddenly rose to the top of the news cycle and became, if briefly, a household name. Suddenly, something in my obscure field of expertise made sense to people who had been mystified about what I actually study, about what is written on the clay tablets I write and teach about. But Ea Natsir's file of complaint letters wasn't a new discovery when the article appeared. The tablets were found a century ago, during excavations at the ancient city of Ur in the 1920s, and have been in the British Museum ever since. By the time the Forbes article came out, Ea Natsir had been discussed in at least 20 scholarly articles, the earliest in 1931. Already in 1967, the letter from Nani was translated into English and included in a book called Letters from Mesopotamia. Ea Natsir was well known in the field of Assyriology, but he had escaped public notice, so he seemed to be a revelation. Who would have guessed that someone living so very long ago could have been so incompetent in such an ordinary way? Here's another surprise, though. He was not alone. There were hundreds, maybe thousands of Ea Natsirs. I don't mean that everyone in the ancient Near East was incompetent. Ea Natsir was a standout in that respect, just that they were very human, and cumulatively, they left behind hundreds of thousands of documents to prove it. If you could have listened in at any doorway in Ur, or any door in any ancient city in the Near East, during ancient times for that matter, you would have heard stories that strike a familiar note. People would have been talking about promising business deals, complicated wedding plans, long-planned trips, unfair bosses, and crazy uncles. You'd have heard arguments over dinner and lullabies at bedtime. In this book, I will take you behind many of those doors to listen in on men and women from the very ancient past. Some of them were famous in their time and wanted to be remembered. They would no doubt be delighted to know that their names have lived on so long after their deaths. Others had no way to make a mark on history. They were illiterate and powerless, subject to the whims of their employers and leaders or the vagaries of climate and agricultural pests. But we know about them anyway. This is because scribes wrote about things that mattered, the things they were asked to write about. Scribes were professionals who had mastered the cuneiform script after years of training. Most other people couldn't read or write. Some of the highest-ranking scribes wrote out royal inscriptions and proclamations at the command of kings and queens, documents that were composed with an eye to impressing the gods and people in the future. But those make up just a tiny percentage of what was written. Most scribes kept track of administrative details for bureaucratic purposes. They made lists of the names of workers and the rations or monthly payments they received, names of taxpayers and the amounts of their contributions, numbers of soldiers called up for a campaign and where they came from, numbers of sheep dedicated for a particular festival, and on and on. Other scribes were hired to record contracts and to write down letters. like the ones sent to Eanatsir. In some eras of ancient Near Eastern history, we know a great deal about the political world of the leaders, kings and queens, priestesses and priests. In some eras, we know very little about the rulers and their achievements, glimpsing them only tangentially. An important diplomatic mission may be revealed to us only because of the survival of an administrative text recording the requisition of a gift for a foreign ruler. In this document, the main actors are the artisan who made the gift and the functionary who requested it. In such a situation, I couldn't write a history of the dynasty if I tried. No one could. For all eras in the ancient Near East, the common people named in the lists, contracts, and letters wildly outnumber the kings and queens, though, admittedly, often the names of those commoners are all we know about them. Ancient Near Eastern history is therefore more of a weathered mosaic than a grand narrative. Parts of it are rich with detail, others frustratingly blank. We are, no doubt, completely unaware of any number of major wars, diplomatic embassies, palace coups, and royal achievements. Our only sources of knowledge are the random documents that have been recovered from archaeological sites and the physical contexts in which they were found. They shine a bright light on odd corners of the ancient Near Eastern world, but we often can't even guess what might be in the documents that did not survive or have not been found yet. So I can't claim that this book covers all the most influential people and events. Instead, we will travel through 3,000 years of history, knocking on doors and settling in for a while with individuals whose lives tell us something about the time in which they lived. Some of those individuals were political and religious leaders, some were officials and scribes, and some were weavers, brickmakers, and brewers. Between them, they will help you to see the history of the ancient Near East in a more intimate way than classic political history allows. Each of the dozens of people whose lives we will visit, in his or her own way, changed the world, from the most powerful king or priestess to the poorest tenant farmer. A direct line can sometimes be traced from their original decisions and innovations to the world we see around us now. They figured out how to live together in cities, how to bake bricks, how to keep track of the calendar, how to make sense of the night skies, how to survey a field, how to examine evidence in a court case, how to negotiate a peace treaty, how to brew beer, how to write, how to trade over long distances, how to create a school curriculum, and so much more. These things happened in other places as well, and I am not claiming that the people of the ancient Near East were the only ones who changed the world, but they were very early to the party and had a tremendous impact. In many cases, these innovations were never forgotten. They were passed down from generation to generation. You may have heard of some of the individuals you will meet in this book, but unless you are a scholar in the field of ancient Near Eastern history, I'm quite sure that many of them will be completely new and surprising to you. Many of them were completely new to everyone in the modern world until recently, when ancient texts mentioning them were discovered and read. The lives of these ancient individuals were far from dull. They, like people in all eras, cared passionately about the events of their times, having no idea what the future held, and the humanity they share with us can be disarming. It is astonishing just how much we know about some people of the ancient Near East, and how deeply we can dive into their world, but it is also striking how little this knowledge has penetrated into the wider consciousness of educated people today. In contrast, other ancient cultures that shared the same general region of the world, Egypt, Israel, Greece, and Rome, are thoroughly familiar and are well represented in books and documentaries about ancient times. This disparity didn't always exist. In the mid-20th century, several books captured the attention of a wide public with their evocative representations of ancient Near Eastern history and archaeology. These included Ur of the Chaldees by Charles Leonard Woolley, History Begins at Sumer by Samuel Noah Kramer, and Treasures of Darkness by Torkild Jacobsen. The ancient Near East deserves our attention now more than ever because of the extraordinary discoveries of the past few decades, to which I will introduce you in the coming chapters. This book begins in the city of Uruk in southern Iraq, around 3500 BCE. Uruk was the first true city anywhere in the ancient Near East, and probably the largest city on earth at the time. It was also where the region's wedge-shaped cuneiform writing was invented, and where scribes first began to learn to read and write in scribal schools. We have scribes to thank for so much. Not only did they write the practical documents on clay tablets that have survived, still thoroughly legible, as both mementos and records of the eras in which they were written, but generations of scribes in school also copied important works of literature, hymns, and royal inscriptions that would otherwise be lost to us. Every document that I quote in this book, and the record of every person that we know by name and can spend time with, exists entirely because scribes wrote them down at some point, and because the tablets and other written works have been discovered in the ground by archaeologists. It is lucky for us that they wrote on clay and stone, which have endured far better than the papyrus and parchment documents of some other ancient cultures. The chapters move forward in time from Uruk in 3500 BCE right through to the 4th century BCE. And as we arrive in each new era, we will stop to meet different people. In the earliest periods, when literacy was monopolized by the great institutions, the temples and palaces, many of the men and women we meet will be kings, queens, officials, and priestesses. As time went on, more and more people hired scribes, fell within the orbit of the great institutions, or became literate themselves, so that we can begin to visit with brickmakers, slaves, soldiers, merchants, musicians, translators, sculptors, diviners, gardeners, brewers, and people in many other professions. Each person's story becomes a window into their era. Imagine that you could sit down with each of them over a beer, which was the drink of choice for almost everyone, in their house or at a local tavern, and could talk about their lives. You would learn so much more about their world than is possible from a general description in a survey. I hope that I have recreated the lives of each of them well enough to give you the same feeling. Archaeology is also a crucial contributor to our understanding. The archaeological evidence, pottery, tools, ovens, jewelry, walls, canals, food remnants, anything at all that has survived in the ground, richly complements textual evidence as scholars reconstruct the past. For that matter, the cuneiform documents themselves are archaeological evidence, every one of them having been found buried after being lost and forgotten for thousands of years. As you might imagine, much changed over the 3,000 years of history covered by this book. One language after another dominated the various regions. People migrated. Technologies changed. Temples and palaces lost and then regained their prominence in the economies. Kingdoms came and went. Cities and sometimes entire regions were abandoned, but later repopulated. Climate crises caused droughts and famines. Epidemics ravaged populations, but eventually subsided. Kings presented themselves sometimes as kind shepherds and sometimes as terrifying warlords. This is not a story of progress. History never really is. For example, women had more prominence and power in society in the 3rd millennium BCE than they did 2,000 years later. Chariots became more maneuverable, but treatment of defeated enemies became harsher. A great many examples come to mind. Life got better, and then it got worse, and then it got better again, and never for all groups in society at the same time. But certain things stayed more or less the same and provide threads running through the cultures, like the strands on a loom. One continuity was the writing system and the system of scribal training. I am limiting the regions covered in this book to those that used cuneiform writing, that is, ancient Iraq, Mesopotamia, Syria, parts of Turkey, Anatolia, northern parts of the Levant, the eastern Mediterranean coastal lands, and parts of Iran, Elam, and later Persia. Occasionally, cuneiform spread to other regions, such as Egypt, Bahrain, Dilmun, the Lake Van region, Urartu, and the southern Levant, in which cases these regions will make brief appearances. Scribes, writing in cuneiform, mostly on clay tablets, will be our guides every step of the way. Another continuity through the eras was people's passionate trust in family as the bedrock of society. For most of the time, men and women had little interest in pigeonholing their friends, neighbors, or, in the case of kings, their subjects, as members of particular social classes. Identification with a particular group, city, or state came and went, but one's family was always crucial. Family also served as a metaphor for many other relationships, such as with bosses, subordinates, allies, and rulers, and it helped define hierarchies, which were always important in this era and region. A third continuity is found in what we now think of as religion. The ancient gods and goddesses, who were worshipped in Uruk when it first grew to be a city, were still worshipped when Alexander of Macedon conquered the region more than 3,000 years later. Across the Near East, almost all peoples considered everyone's deities to be real and powerful. But they didn't think of the deities as being part of anything they could separate, in their minds, from the rest of life. They had no abstract concept of religion. To them, the gods and goddesses existed, they were real, they controlled everything, and they made non-negotiable demands of their human subjects. Much of life was spent discerning what they wanted, providing for them, and not getting on their bad side. Oaths provided a way to call on the gods to assess the truth of a claim and to hold people to their promises. Oaths were never taken lightly. This system of thought made perfect sense and fit with the evidence of their senses. The world offered no other explanation. Government could not be extricated in even the smallest way from the world of the gods. Kings ruled because the gods wanted them to, and they had to expend a great deal of energy and wealth on the gods' needs. Throughout ancient Near Eastern history, temples were homes to the gods, in the form of statues, and homes to statues of the kings who worshipped them. Those temple homes often stayed in exactly the same places in the cities for thousands of years, rebuilt from time to time, but almost never moved. The kings provide a fourth continuity across time. The people of the ancient Near East believed that the gods wanted them to be ruled by kings. And in three millennia, no viable alternate system of government ever developed. The kings were sometimes advised by councils or assemblies or high officials, and those individuals could have considerable clout. But in almost every place and time, one can identify a king who was at the top of the administrative hierarchy. Theirs was a world dominated by powerful men, most of whom had inherited their power from their fathers. That said, it was also a world with plenty of powerful women, including queens, who advised or even ruled with their husbands or sons. Priestesses, in particular, oversaw many of the human interactions with gods and gained authority and wealth by running vast estates belonging to temples. We will encounter other continuities as well. Justice was always sought and corruption condemned. One reason so many documents survive is that contracts had to be drawn up for a wide variety of purposes, just in case anyone involved in a transaction needed to go to court. The ownership and use of real estate played a profound role throughout the ancient history of the region, as did the employment and payment of vast workforces by the great institutions. Wide disparities of wealth separated rich court officials from tenant farmers and manual laborers. Slavery existed in all eras, as was true in so many ancient societies, but the economies were not based on slavery. And the weavers mentioned in the title of this book played an important role in all eras. Textiles represented many things: a commodity created by workshops in palaces and temples, a valuable export, a fine art, and a lifelong occupation for just about every woman. Even those who were not professional textile workers spent many of their waking hours spinning thread for their family's clothing. Anywhere people were living, some of them, usually women, were weaving. Contrary to popular misconceptions, the ancient Near East was not a perpetually violent place. Wars certainly happened. In some eras, they must have seemed endless to the people living through them. But diplomacy was almost always attempted before military conflicts were declared, and combatants almost always sought peace. Conquering forces often treated defeated armies and their leaders harshly, but within cities and communities, people were remarkably civil to one another. Courts existed to prevent vigilante justice. Judges weighed evidence carefully, and people accepted their decisions. Laws might have prescribed harsh punishments for crimes, but most actual punishments, as reflected in written accounts of court cases, took the form of monetary fines. Throughout the millennia, random crimes against strangers seem to have been rare, happening mostly in situations outside the context of cities. For example, when merchants might be robbed when traveling. Even then, the incensed kings who represented the merchants insisted on justice from the rulers of the land in which the robbery took place. In sum, you will find that you will be visiting an unfamiliar, but exciting, innovative, and generally civil and humane place in this book. Excepting, that is, the behavior of some of the more brutal individuals who seem to show up throughout history. It was a place and time that has had a huge influence on the cultures that followed it. The people of the ancient Near East developed diplomacy around the same time they developed organized warfare. They wrote legal contracts almost as soon as they could write anything. And for the most part, they cared about their fellow humans. And they wanted to be remembered. I'm pleased to be able to play a small part in making that last wish a reality for a few dozen ancient people who had not even the vaguest notion of the future world in which their names would indeed be remembered. They deserve our attention. A few additional notes before we go on. First, Almost all the dates in the book are BCE, or before the Common Era, also referred to as BC. Of course, the people of the time had their own ways of identifying years. Sometimes they named the years, either by a great event or the name of a high official. Sometimes they numbered the years within a particular king's reign. The correlation between their dates and our years BCE is not set in stone. Scholars are still working on perfecting the chronology. I'm using dates in the so-called middle chronology, which is widely used and increasingly seems likely to be correct. The earliest dates in the book are the least certain, but they gradually become more reliable as one approaches the first millennium BCE. The relative order of events that historians have reconstructed is reliable, and dates in the last four chapters of the book are mostly not disputed. I have provided regnal dates for kings, if these dates are known. Second, a few ancient Near Eastern individuals were already known from writings by Greek, Roman, or biblical authors before records from their own time were recovered. In these cases, for simplicity, I use the more familiar names rather than the ones the individuals used during their lifetimes. Third, I have quoted from ancient sources throughout the book so that the ancient voices can come through and tell their own tales. But because they wrote on documents that are now often fragmentary or abraded, there are places where words are missing. Fourth, I should note that other cultures in adjoining regions also had rich histories with profound impacts on world history, and they were periodically in contact with the peoples on whom this book focuses, especially through trade. This included not just Egypt, Nubia, and much of the Levant, but also the Giraffe culture of Iran, the Harappan culture of the Indus Valley, and later cultures of South Asia, the Minoan, Mycenaean, and later Greek cultures of the Aegean, and Magan, along with the Kedarite and other cultures of Arabia. These regions did not, however, use cuneiform as their main medium of written communication, so I made the choice not to include them in this book. This has allowed me to focus on individuals and their lives, and to trace continuities through cuneiform history. But the web of connections among ancient peoples was profound and long-lasting, with influences flowing in all directions. And finally, no, Ea Natsir is not among the people featured in this book. He has had his moment in the sun. Feel free to look him up online. Other ancient Near Eastern individuals were just as engaging, as you will find. Part 1, the Uruk period, 3500 to 2900 BCE. Chapter 1, Builders and Organizers. Around 3500 BCE, a huge change began to take place in southern Mesopotamia, one that had ramifications for the rest of human history. Large numbers of people began to live in densely packed communities with thousands of other people, namely cities. And once they began to live in cities, a whole lot of changes followed in the ways people interacted with one another, the ways they were governed, the types of technology they used, and any number of other aspects of life. By this time, humans had been living on the planet for millions of years, modern humans, Homo sapiens sapiens, for around 200,000 years. They had been speaking fully developed languages for at least tens of thousands of years. They had migrated and settled across the planet. Throughout all these millennia, people were on the move, seasonally following their sources of food as animals migrated and plants ripened in different areas. Archaeologists find burials, cave paintings, intricate stone and bone tools, and small sculptures, tantalizing evidence of people with sophisticated technologies and ideas, and certainly with religious beliefs and explanations of the world they saw around them. These hunters and gatherers sometimes created extraordinary monuments that would challenge people of any era to build, especially without modern technology. The best known is at Göbekli Tepe in southeast Anatolia, now Turkey. But there must have been others like it. 12,000 years ago, hundreds of people gathered at Göbekli Tepe to create a series of circles of engraved T-shaped standing stones, the largest of which weighed 16 tons. The incised images are of animals of prey, such as lions, scorpions, vultures, and snakes. This must have been a place of great importance for the people who built and visited it. But because writing didn't develop until 7,000 years after it was built, we can only guess at its meaning. Around the same time as the construction of the monument at Göbekli Tepe, humans in a few places in the Near East first settled in small communities that they occupied year-round. Initially, people living in these communities supported themselves by hunting wild animals and gathering plants that were available locally. It was no coincidence that in the Near East, early villages were often located near stands of wild wheat and barley, that, after being harvested, could be stored over long periods to feed a settled population. Only after they had settled did people begin to farm. This transformation has sometimes been called the agricultural revolution, but people living through it would have experienced nothing revolutionary. Farming and herding seem to have crept into the economy, only very gradually coming to replace hunting and gathering. This period is called the Neolithic, and in the Near East, it lasted from about 10,000 BCE to around 5300 BCE. During the Neolithic, people in the Near East traded for goods they needed and luxury goods they wanted over vast areas and for a very long time. Shells spread out from the Red Sea, passing from person to person and being treasured in many places. Obsidian, a volcanic glass that was particularly sharp and useful for stone tools, spread from central Anatolia, modern Turkey. Other beautiful stones were transported all the way from Afghanistan to Mesopotamia, modern Iraq. By 6500 BCE, some of the finest pottery in all of history was already being manufactured by specialists. People lived in neatly built rectangular brick or stone houses with plaster floors. Most Neolithic communities were small, just a few dozen people, but a few grew to considerable size. Çatalhöyük, in what is now Turkey, boasted a remarkably large population of between 3,500 and 8,000 people in the mid-7th millennium BCE. Its population seems to have been egalitarian, with an equal distribution of wealth, and the city was not dominated by monumental buildings like later cities. Although Çatalhöyük can be described as a city based on its population size, it didn't give rise to an urban culture in its region. As the Neolithic came to an end, people had moved into southern Mesopotamia. The coast of the Persian Gulf was considerably further north than it is now, though scholars disagree about where it actually was located. And the Tigris and Euphrates rivers, with their origins in what is now Turkey, took their separate winding courses across the hot, almost rainless floodplain of southern Iraq, eventually reaching marshland and spilling into the Gulf. People settled there in the 5th millennium BCE, north of the marshlands, in an area that was ideal for their needs. The soil was rich from the silt carried down by the rivers. The water was fresh, not salty, and it spread out across the landscape in fans of small channels. These fans could be managed so that the land they passed through could hold onto floodwater for longer. People began to construct banks and dams to create basins to achieve this. This is called basin irrigation, and it provided enough water for annual crops of barley and wheat. The communities in which the people settled grew larger than villages, larger than towns. All of which is to say that, by the mid-4th millennium BCE, the world was already a sophisticated place, with plenty of history and tradition, and in spite of the hot, dry climate, southern Mesopotamia was an excellent place to live. People at the time had interests and skills. They no doubt talked about fascinating things. They loved their families, they worried about the crops, and they had expertise that most of us have long since lost. They knew how to store their grain so that it would be safe from vermin and insects. They knew how to spin flax into linen thread using a spindle whorl and how to weave that thread into fabric. They knew how to create a perfect blade by chipping a flint block just so. Cities developed independently in other regions of the globe, of course, but as far as we can tell, in 3500 BCE, the largest city on Earth, and one of the earliest, was in southern Mesopotamia. The city's name was Uruk. It was situated by the Euphrates River, right in that ideal area where basin irrigation produced abundant crops, around 120 kilometers from what was then the coast of the Gulf. For this first chapter, I can provide you with no names for the inhabitants of Uruk whose lives interest us. The people of the middle of the 4th millennium BCE certainly had them, each one a phrase or sentence that had meaning in their language, but they are all lost to us. In later periods, scribes wrote letters, lists, inscriptions, contracts, and many other types of documents that provide us with evidence about the people who lived at the time. But until the late 4th millennium BCE, writing had not yet developed. We face much more of a challenge to see the world through their eyes without more detailed text to help us. So, as we begin to look at what life was like in Uruk before writing came along, we will explore other types of evidence of individuals who lived around 3500 BCE and experience some of the biggest changes in all of human history as they accustomed themselves to urban life. At that time, perhaps as many as 40,000 of the newly urbanized people lived in Uruk. A gathering of that many people today at a football stadium would be unremarkable, and a town of 40,000 is not a big place in the modern world. But for the 4th millennium BCE, it was astounding. The world had never seen anything like it. In fact, a city that big continued to be a rarity for millennia. Uruk was 2.5 square kilometers in extent and was on a completely different scale from its neighbors, 10 times the size, in fact, of the next biggest city in the region. Uruk was already the same size as Athens in 500 BCE, 3,000 years later. Uruk in the 4th millennium BCE was altogether a remarkable place to be. People living there experienced a style of life that had never existed before. It created the mold for all Mesopotamian cities to come. This period also saw the creation of the artistic style of the Mesopotamians. It saw the development of a system of accounting and of weights and measures that placed subsequent Mesopotamian economies on a sound footing. It saw the invention of a writing system that allowed information about their culture to pass down through the ages. Incredibly, after this abrupt and almost uncanny start, these institutions and others continued for thousands of years and had an impact on the surrounding cultures as well. Uruk had existed as a smaller community for at least 1,000 years before this, but now that it had grown so large, its people faced new challenges. For one thing, the city needed organizing. We tend to assume that any large group of people in pre-modern times must have had a powerful man in charge. After all, once monarchy developed in any region, that system of government tended to become deeply established and pretty much unassailable. Uruk had no clear royal palace at this time, however, and no names of kings are preserved once they began to write, and yet some person or some group of people must have been running the place. Archaeologists and historians of this era have gone in search of these individuals. Who were they? Excavations at Uruk. When the first archaeologists came to dig at Uruk in 1913, they encountered a site that was vast and unexplored. Not much was known about the beginnings of urban culture back then. The discoveries at Uruk and those of other archaeologists in southern Iraq vastly expanded the world's knowledge of early cities. Over the decades, the German team heading the excavation returned year after year, with interruptions for world wars and local conflicts, and they discovered temples, palaces, and walls that had been built over a 5,000-year period, from the 5th millennium BCE to the 5th century CE. Imagine, one city stood on exactly the same spot for 5,000 years, at the end of which the Roman Empire was still around. What we lumped together as ancient history lasted for a very, very long time. In fact, Uruk lasted long enough that over the centuries, the city had grown higher and higher in elevation above the floodplain. This was true of all ancient cities in the Near East. The debris that was generated just by living, the broken walls and abandoned floors and forgotten trash, was rarely swept away. The debris just stayed where it was, and time and again was incorporated into new floors and streets as new buildings were constructed. The giant mounds that formed are now, and were then, called tells. Even the word is ancient. The German archaeologists at Uruk dug down through many layers of occupation. The city remained important long after the 4th millennium. In 1928, they began to excavate the levels that were laid down during the 4th millennium BCE. And what they found were buildings and artifacts of unanticipated and stunning sophistication. The archaeologists assigned Roman numerals to these levels of occupation, starting with 1 for the top, most recent level, then 2, 3, and so on, for the earlier levels. These level numbers are still in use. A little confusingly, the numbers therefore get smaller as one moves forward in time, so that the city of Uruk level 6 existed before Uruk 5, which existed before Uruk 4, which existed before Uruk 3. Together, these levels, 6 through 3, constitute what is called the Uruk period, named for the city because Uruk seems to have taken the lead in technological and social innovation, providing a model for other cities across the Near East. A visitor to the Stone Cone Temple. Two great temple complexes dominated the city in the Uruk period. We know from later eras that one was dedicated to the god An, the god of the heavens, the sky, and the other to the goddess Inanna, who controlled love and warfare. Inanna's temple complex was called the Eanna, the house of the heavens. Within the Eanna stood a truly remarkable building, We often describe things offhandedly as unique, while knowing that it's not really true. But this building was exactly that. Nothing remotely like it has ever been found. It was constructed during what the excavators called Level 6, around perhaps 3500 BCE. The archaeologists discovered only its foundations and the layers of debris from when it was abandoned, but it's possible to reconstruct what it would have looked like when newly built and to explore some of the extraordinary innovations that the architect or architects introduced into it. A man from another ancient town, let's say the town of Ur to the south, might have come to visit the Aeana during Level 6, arriving in Uruk at a southern gate in the wall of the city. Turning around to survey the countryside before entering, the visitor would have been struck by the flatness of the landscape. The Euphrates River flowed next to the city, a wide band of water heading for the lower sea, the Persian Gulf to us, beyond the horizon. Reed boats with high prows sailed southward, following the current. Boats going north could be seen being towed with ropes by people walking along a riverside path. As far as his eye could see and beyond, the whole of southern Mesopotamia was a wide river valley. Off to the east, though not visible from Uruk, flowed the Euphrates' twin river, the Tigris. Between them, these two great rivers had laid down a vast landscape of silt. This dominating feature provided the origin of the name given to the region by the ancient Greeks. It was between, meso, the rivers, potamia. Fields surrounded by banks stretched out along natural channels around the base of the tell on which Uruk stood, and farmers would have been at work everywhere. Their towns and villages dotted the landscape as well, the bigger towns raised from the plain on tells of their own. In the region around Uruk, archaeologists have found the remains of many smaller communities, which would have been dependent on the city. Next to the riverbank and the riverside path stood orchards of date palms, planted slightly higher than the fields, growing on the natural levees that had built up on the edge of the Euphrates. The visitor entered Uruk and made his way towards the city center. It was a very different experience to live in a city than in a village or small town. People on the streets were mostly strangers, even to other residents of Uruk. Any given person could have been acquainted with only a small fraction of the city's population. Living in such proximity to so many strangers was an unusual experience at this point in human history, though in any given neighborhood, people probably lived close to family members. This was true throughout Mesopotamian history. Family bonds were very tight. The visitor walked on along the dusty streets, which were lined with windowless mud brick houses without breaks between them. The excavators didn't explore the neighborhoods of Uruk, but we have a sense of what they would have been like from excavations of other towns and cities of the same era. Some houses opened onto pleasant internal courtyards. Others had long central halls with rooms opening off them. But every house kept its secrets from people in the street. There were no front yards or spaces between the houses. Adjoining houses shared walls. The man visiting from Ur probably kept close to the walls to take advantage of their shade. The weather in southern Mesopotamia was hot for most of the year, and the sun unforgiving. We moderns take living in cities for granted. We expect services like trucks that haul away our trash, pipes that bring clean water, sewage systems that whisk away our waste, grocery stores that provide fresh food, and hospitals that help us when we're ill, all of which make life in a densely packed community manageable. The people of Uruk shared with us many of the same needs, but had none of the conveniences. They needed water and food, along with oil to light their homes, wool to make their clothing, bricks and clay to repair their houses. All these had to be carried into the city. Meanwhile, they produced all kinds of waste and trash, which they either threw into the street or dropped from the edge of the tell. They must have been annoyed by the loud noises of animals and people in the street, and they must have been vulnerable to diseases that could have spread easily in such a close community. Altogether, you might imagine life there to have been a sort of bedlam. Old village hierarchies based on families, which would have kept the peace in villages, wouldn't have worked to contain the whims, plans, and passions of tens of thousands of people. So, was living in Uruk dangerous and chaotic? It seems not. The evidence suggests that it was a well-run place and that people lived there not under duress, but voluntarily. Studies of skeletal remains have shown that, not just in Uruk, but throughout Mesopotamia at this time, people were less likely to be struck in the head than in surrounding regions. It was not an especially violent place. From a distance, the visitor would have spotted the most prominent feature on the Uruk skyline, a temple raised on a platform. It was probably dedicated to the god of the heavens, known as An, who was worshipped in a temple on that spot for many centuries to follow. The platform and temple had been built and rebuilt over centuries, and the temple itself was plastered and would have gleamed a bright white in the sunshine. The excavators called it the White Temple. The visitor chose not to go there. His destination was the Eanna Temple, to the goddess Inanna. As he approached, he would have noticed a long plastered wall that seemed from a distance to have been painted with dark vertical stripes. On drawing closer, it would have become clear that the stripes were the shadows of dozens of vertical buttresses, evenly spaced along the wall surrounding a rectangular enclosure. He would not have been able to tell because of the plaster coating, but this wall was built from limestone, not the usual mud brick that had been used in construction for centuries. For most Urukians, this was probably the extent of their access to this sacred spot. But let us say our visitor was a high-ranking person who was allowed inside the wall. There, he encountered a dazzling courtyard space, gleaming with bright colors in regular geometric patterns. The inside face of the enclosure wall, and the walls of the impressive temple that it surrounded, were all decorated in mosaics. Various geometric, symmetrical, blue and yellow-green patterns appeared on the surrounding wall, while red, white, and black mosaic diamond shapes decorated the walls of the building inside the enclosure. All the stone for the mosaics on the temple had been carefully carved into innumerable small cones, each about 10 to 13 centimeters long. Only the circular flat ends of the cones made up the mosaics. Their sharp points were set into the wall. They are the earliest known mosaics anywhere. Someone had worked out a way to keep the cones in place. Archaeologists found thousands of rectangular clay plaques, each about 21 centimeters long, with curved ends and small holes at each end. They had been set in horizontal rows, sticking out from the walls, between each layer of building material. Perhaps a grid was threaded through the holes, providing a support structure for the small but heavy stone cones and to make sure they were placed accurately, like knots in a giant stone carpet. The German archaeologists who excavated the building called this the Steinstift Temple, or Stone Cone Temple. But the ancient visitor would not have been aware of the cones, only of the beautiful diamond patterns in the brilliant colors that their polished circular ends formed on the walls. They gave the whole building the look of a giant jewel box. Perhaps the strangest feature of the Stone Cone Temple was the composition of the walls that supported the mosaics. For thousands of years, people in the Near East had been building structures out of reeds and mud brick, or of stone if they lived near a source of building stone. Note, though, that until the time of the Stone Cone Temple, stone had almost never been used for building in the southern stretches of the Mesopotamian River Valley, because it didn't occur there naturally. In some regions, plaster was often used as a coating on the walls and floors. It was created by burning limestone at around 600 degrees centigrade to turn it into a dry powder. As with modern plaster of Paris, water was then added to the dry powder, which made it malleable or spreadable. Once the plaster dried, it became hard and water-resistant. People had been making lime plaster this way for more than 4,000 years before the Stone Cone Temple was constructed. It even predated the invention of pottery. In the 8th and 7th millennia BCE, in regions of the Levant, plaster had briefly been tried as a medium for vessels and sculpture. But clay had proved to make superior pots, the plaster ones disintegrated over a fire, and stone made longer-lasting sculptures, so their plaster equivalents had long since gone out of fashion. Nevertheless, someone involved in the planning of the Stone Cone Temple had a bright idea about plaster. Perhaps, this person thought, burned lime combined with crushed bricks might make a new and sturdy building material. It could be poured into molds in layers and would set hard. The archaeologists who dug up the temple recognized the walls as being made of a form of concrete, used in a confoundingly early historical context. Most ancient innovations can be traced over a long period of development, and they continued to be perfected, so it's hard to imagine a single mind behind them. There are almost no ancient Thomas Edisons. But the walls of the Stone Cone Temple are so strange that they suggest the existence of an anonymous inventor trying a new experimental building technique. The architects must have been aware of the structural complications of the weight of the concrete walls of the stone cone temple, along with the weight of the cones themselves. The building has a much more substantial limestone and clay foundation than was normal, and this seems to have been added specifically in order to support the extra weight of the building. Scholars have also calculated that the stone cone temple was much more costly in terms of the effort involved to construct it than any other comparable monumental building of the Uruk period, even though it wasn't the largest. Our visitor to the temple would not, however, have been aware of the deep foundations or the concrete walls, which were invisible under the stone mosaics. Inside the temple, in the relative cool of the high-ceilinged rooms, the diamond-shaped mosaic patterns continued on the walls. The core of the temple was a long room flanked by smaller rooms on both its long sides. This three-part design has been dubbed the tripartite temple form, and it became the classic template for temples in the Uruk period, though subsequent tripartite temples were built of mud brick. Yet again, though, the stone cone temple broke the mold and was unlike any other tripartite temple. This is because it contained a large L-shaped pool that was 13.7 meters long and 0.8 meters deep and took up an entire room. The pool had been created to be watertight, and it was not the only room for which this was true. The floors of the whole temple were waterproofed with imported bitumen. In the long central room, the bitumen was, in turn, coated with a waterproof lime plaster, and a channel crossed its floor diagonally to allow water to flow. In fact, everything about the stone cone temple was designed to be waterproof. Even the stone cones themselves would not have been affected by long exposure to water. So perhaps water was not confined to the pool. It could have covered the floor and flowed from the doors into the courtyard during some rites or festivals. Unlike clay cones, stone ones would not have eroded in water, and the concrete walls would have fared much better than mud brick. The floor of the central hall was imprinted with post holes, into which 2-meter-tall bronze rods would have been placed. Perhaps they supported a canopy, under which a statue of the god, or a priest, would have been seated. These rods were later preserved, buried all together in a brick hut in the courtyard, with lime plaster from the floor of the hall still stuck to their ends. Had our visitor arrived on a festival day, he might have witnessed a ceremony in which the whole complex became a giant reflecting pool, mirroring the bright mosaics of the walls and the blue of the sky. Bronze standards stood at the doorway to the structure, and the god himself, in the form of his statue, could perhaps have been seen under a canopy in the central hall. The god of water, named Enki, was often portrayed in just this way on cylinder seals. What, though, was the use of the L-shaped pool? No one knows. But water certainly played a big role in the life of the temple. The goddess Inanna, to whom this temple complex was dedicated in later historic times, wasn't a water deity, so this building probably wasn't hers. About a century later, the stone cone temple was ritually destroyed, and then, as though it had been an important person, it was, in a way, buried in a brick monument. This was a square, subterranean, doorless structure, built right into a corner of the ruins of the stone cone temple. It looks like a tomb, but no body was found inside. This smaller, newer structure, conservatively built of mud bricks rather than concrete, was filled with all manner of treasures, from copper and stone vessels to jewelry, weapons, furniture, and storage jars, and also with animal bones. These had been piled more than 2 feet high in a corridor and covered in matting. The burial of the stone cone temple was then completed as the remaining spaces in the room of the newer building were filled with debris from the earlier structure. A fire that torched and discolored the walls of the central chamber of the tomb might have been accidental, or it might have been ceremonial. Robbers looted some sections of the tomb in ancient times, but many of the rich goods that had been interred were untouched. One wonders who left them there and why the stone cone temple was so important as to deserve this treatment. Construction of the Stone Cone Temple. Although so much is mysterious, the planning behind the Stone Cone Temple can be guessed at. It proves to be remarkable and tells us a lot about this earliest of cities. The very existence of the structure shows that innovation was supported by whoever was in charge, and also shows that people of Uruk worked by the thousands to create truly glorious monuments for their gods. The temples, in turn, may have attracted more residents to Uruk, the presence of the deities providing divine protection to the population. The workers were almost certainly called up from among the free population as a labor duty to the state, known as corvée labor. Just as a man might be drafted to serve in the military, so he might be drafted to construct a building. Corvée workers toiled on state projects throughout ancient Near Eastern history. Once plans had been finalized and workers enlisted, by whoever had this authority, the construction materials had to be obtained, and most of these came from regions far from Uruk. Had it been a normal mud brick temple, like the ones that had come before it, or like the contemporary temple to the god An in a nearby neighborhood, the brickmaking could have commenced right there in the city. But the builders of the stone cone temple were more ambitious. Fortunately, the Urukians didn't live in isolation from the world beyond their city. They knew where to find the building materials they needed. The limestone for the enclosure wall and the foundations, and to burn for the concrete, could be imported from relatively close by. There was a source about 50 kilometers away to the west. Scholars have calculated the quantities of every material used in the temple, and they estimated that the walls required about 1,400 cubic meters of concrete, and the foundations and enclosure wall used almost 1,300 cubic meters of limestone. Each cubic meter of limestone weighs 2,711 kilograms, so the weight of stone in the walls and foundation can be estimated to have been 3,795,400 kilograms, or 3,886 tons. That doesn't include the limestone for the concrete walls. The transportation of such a large amount of limestone overland was no simple matter. Wagons may not have been in use yet. The wheel had been invented and was used in Mesopotamia by the Uruk period. But there's a lot to building a successful cart, and it's unlikely that they had one yet, let alone one that could support the weight of large amounts of building stone. So the limestone may have been dragged on sleds, and 50 kilometers is a long way when you're dragging heavy stones. Thousands of workmen were probably involved in the quarrying and transport. The source for the bitumen was about 400 kilometers north of Uruk on the Euphrates, and the colored stones for the decorative cones and the long timbers necessary for roofing the interior spaces had to travel much further, all the way from the mountains far to the north. The bitumen and stone would have been transported on boats, and the logs could be floated downstream, tied together as rafts. But someone first had to travel to the places where they were available and negotiate for the large quantities required. These natural resources lay in settled areas and were certainly not free for the taking to anyone who showed up. Once the deal had been struck, an official probably also oversaw the quarrying and logging and watched to see that everything was loaded properly. It has been estimated that the stone cone building required about 50 cubic meters of bitumen, 40 cubic meters of fine colored stone for the cones, and more than 100 cubic meters of timber. After the materials arrived, the corvée laborers, almost certainly men, who formed the workforce for hard labor in all later eras of Mesopotamian history, must have burned limestone in kilns, mixed in crushed bricks, and waited to add water until just the right time so that it set when it was supposed to. Others manufactured and fired the terracotta plaques that were to be laid between layers of concrete. Still others spent their days carving and polishing colored stones to create thousands of cones. When construction started, each phase of the process must have been carefully planned. The materials had to be at the building site and available to the workmen who needed them. The concrete had to be poured in the wall molds and allowed to set at just the right moment. The cones had to be placed in meticulous arrangements before the concrete dried, presumably following a grid marked into the wall. All the workmen employed on the project also needed plenty of water to drink in the hot climate, along with food to eat. These must have been provided by the administration that enlisted them. It seems likely that there was nothing about this whole operation that was unplanned. The obvious conclusion from all this must be that someone, or some group of people, was in charge. Organizing the workforce. The excavators at Uruk estimated that the construction of a mud brick terrace in the Ayana precinct involved 1,500 men laboring 10 hours a day for 5 years. But many more structures were being built than just a single terrace. The demands for labor must have been fairly constant. How were the workers paid? Who paid them? Who organized their work shifts and how? All of this took place before writing was invented, so how did anyone keep track of all the materials, crew, building schedules, and provisions? For these questions, happily, we have more than guesswork. scholars have taken fragments of evidence and pieced together a picture of how it all worked. In the ruins of the Stone Cone Temple, archaeologists found some rather prosaic objects that help provide answers: clay balls, clay tokens, and broken pottery. The clay balls, often called bullae, might be unimpressive to look at, but they represented an ingenious way of keeping track of commodities, and perhaps people. Suppose someone wanted to record a quantity of bitumen that was being sent to Uruk and to make sure that all the bitumen arrived, with no theft along the way. The shipper made small clay tokens in a shape that was agreed upon to represent jars of bitumen. The tokens look a little like game pieces. And then placed them inside a ball made of clay that had not set hard. He sealed the ball, baked it in the sun, and sent it along with the shipment. When everything arrived, the official in Uruk could count the number of jars in the shipment and check it against the number of tokens. If they matched up, all was well. If not, he would have had questions for the shipping agent. There were plenty of other uses for the tokens and bullae: for record keeping, and to aid in remembering numbers of commodities and people. They had been in wide use right across the Near East, long before level 6 at Uruk. In fact, 16 bullae were found under the foundations of the Stone Cone Temple. Those had been used and discarded before it was even constructed. Other tokens were found in the debris of the ruined temple and in the memorial structure that was built for it. They represented a very useful administrative tool. The outsides of the bullae were not necessarily blank. Some of the ones under the Stone Cone Temple had been sealed. Perhaps the agent shipping bitumen from the region to the north wanted to make sure that no one cheated by breaking the bulla, taking out a couple of tokens so as to hide his theft of jars, and making a new one, enclosing fewer tokens. The shipping agent could ensure against such tampering by rolling his cylinder seal across the surface of the original bulla. As long as the receiving agent in Uruk recognized the seal impression, he could be sure that the shipment had arrived intact. Whereas bullae and clay tokens were old news by 3500 BCE, cylinder seals were relatively new. Stamp seals had existed for thousands of years, so the concept of sealing was a familiar one. But a cylinder seal had the advantage that it could seal the whole surface of a bulla. To make such a seal, an artisan carved a scene or intricate pattern in reverse relief onto the surface of a cylindrical bead, so that when it was rolled on clay, the impression could be as long as needed, repeated over and over. At this time, each cylinder seal seems to have been controlled either by a particular person, or more likely, by an office, so that the sealing could be read, identifying who had sealed the bulla and enclosed the tokens, and therefore was responsible for the shipment. People started sealing other things as well, rooms and jars in particular. Clay was ubiquitous, so it was easy enough to place a lump of it on a closed jar or on a closed door latch, and to roll a cylinder seal across the clay. Anyone could see if the seal was broken, and the seal impression identified who had last been in the room or who had sealed the jar. Like the bullae and tokens, the sealings created a message that could be understood later, and by people who didn't have to speak directly to the original sealer. The pottery fragments found in the ruins of the Stone Cone Temple hint at how workers in the Ayana precinct, including all the workers constructing the temple itself, were provided for. Pots in the Uruk period were mostly of two kinds. About one-fifth of the potsherds found in the Uruk period levels came from wheel-made ceramics. These marked a significant technological advance, in that they could be made more quickly than the carefully coiled handmade pots of previous eras. A type of mass production of good quality ceramics had become possible. The other four-fifths of the potsherds, the vast majority, were from coarse, shallow, cone-shaped bowls with thick walls and a beveled rim, which could be made even more quickly than those created on a pottery wheel. They were manufactured simply by pressing clay into a mold and baking the resulting bowl, and each held approximately a liter of a dry substance. They were porous, so they would have been useless to hold liquids. Unlike so many objects from the Uruk period, these beveled rim bowls were not made carefully or neatly. On the other hand, they are so ubiquitous in Uruk period sites across the Near East that it's clear that they were both essential and disposable, the Starbucks cups of their era. One scholar calculated that a single family could have thrown away as many as 280 such bowls a year. Scholars disagree about whether the beveled-rimmed bowls were containers for daily grain rations for workers or were bread molds. Either way, they were associated with food. We know this because the symbol for bread and food in the later cuneiform writing system was exactly the shape of this type of bowl, and the symbol for to eat was a head with just such a bowl to its lips. Whether they were for grain or for bread, an institution, almost certainly a temple, seems to have made the bowls and used them to distribute rations to workers, including those who labored in all the construction jobs on the stone cone temple. This system predated the temple. The bowls were already found hundreds of years earlier, in level 10 at Uruk, and for all that time, large numbers of people had been provided with food, both fairly and efficiently. The trash found in the ruins of the temple therefore tells us a great deal, that workers were provided with food in cheap, standardized bowls, that records of materials being used were kept using clay tokens sealed in bullae, and that accountability for stores and shipments was improved with cylinder seals impressed on clay. On the whole, though, and in spite of efforts at understanding its construction, the stone cone temple is a glorious enigma. We don't know what happened inside it, why it had its unique features, and why it later warranted its own tomb, but it obviously meant a lot to the people. It also seems ultimately to have been judged to have been an engineering failure. For one thing, it's clear that the beautiful stone cone mosaics were not securely held by the lime plaster, and whole sections of them fell off the wall. And the people of Uruk don't seem to have tried building with this type of concrete again. There's really nothing else like the stone cone temple anywhere. The priest king of Uruk. The cylinder seals also have another story to tell that goes beyond their administrative applications. The scenes engraved on them provide miniature windows into life in Uruk more than 5,000 years ago. With surprising naturalism, especially given the tiny scale of the seals, the artisans who made them revealed quotidian details, such as scenes of animals grazing in the pastures and people farming, irrigating their fields, fishing and weaving. The choice of design may not have been arbitrary. It may have reflected the office or person for whom the seal was made. So, for example, a number of seals show women lined up together, weaving on looms, apparently working in some kind of textile workshop. The owner of this seal might have been the supervisor of such a workshop. In later eras, inscriptions on the seals identified the owners, but in this era, before writing, it makes sense that the figures and activities depicted were expected to do the same thing. If so, the seals could represent a form of recorded communication. Some of the most intricate seals found in the early levels at Uruk were carved with ritual scenes, and in these, you can often pick out a particular object that had a deep symbolic significance to the Urukians, a tall reed bundle with a ring at the top and a streamer hanging down. This was the symbol of the great goddess of the land, Inanna. A drawing of the reed bundle became the way to write her name. The Eanna, as we have seen, was Inanna's temple complex. The ritual scenes on seals also often show a man who seems to have held an important position. He was generally portrayed the same way each time, wearing specific clothes. We're getting closer here to being able to create a mental image of a leader who may have managed the complicated machinery of administration at Uruk. You can see this man on a cylinder seal that is currently in the British Museum and another in the collection at Yale. He is bearded and wears a headband and a robe made of some sort of open netting that falls almost to his ankles. The artist has managed to depict the delicate weave of the net over the man's legs and body. In the Yale seal, he holds out two branches to a group of animals, and in the scene on the British Museum seal, the artist also included three of the reed bundles representing Inanna. In a group of five other cylinder seals that were found together at Uruk, the same figure, again in the net robe, is shown with the goddess herself, recognizable again by the reed bundles. Between the two figures stand two tall conical baskets filled with offerings. One way or another, the man in the net robe is often shown in some association with Inanna. When a ritual offering is taking place, he provides food to the goddess. In other seals, however, a man with the same characteristics is shown hunting, sometimes with no sign of the goddess at all. A few fighting scenes on seals represent him with a long spear, accompanied by victorious soldiers who are standing, along with vanquished soldiers, who are naked and cowering on the ground, their hands tied. This suggests that warfare was already an organized pursuit, led by the same man who had a priestly role. He has, therefore, been dubbed the Priest King of Uruk. The Priest King doesn't just appear on cylinder seals. One of the most remarkable works of art found by archaeologists in the Eanna temple complex was a narrow alabaster vase, more than a meter tall, which was carved with scenes that wrap right around it, almost as though it had been impressed with enormous cylinder seals. It's known as the Uruk vase. The Priest King appeared here too. The uppermost scene, just below the rim, bears a strong resemblance to the ritual scenes on cylinder seals. Just as on the seals, Inanna is shown on the right-hand side of the scene, next to her reed bundle symbol. She has the same long hair and plain robe with a band along the bottom that is seen on the cylinder seals. In front of her, again, you see a conical basket full of offerings, as on the seals, but this time it's carried by a naked male figure. On the left, the Priest King in his net skirt stands facing toward Inanna, just as he does on the ritual cylinder seals. Unfortunately, on the vase, most of the figure of the Priest King is broken. His image may have been cut out of the vase on purpose. All that is left are his feet and the bottom of his net skirt, but it's clearly him. In the vase, he even has a long-haired attendant behind him, holding up what seems to be a sash to his net skirt. This top register of the vase includes some details on the right that aren't found on cylinder seals. Behind Inanna and the two reed bundles, which would have marked the entrance to the sanctuary of the goddess, are some items that would have been found inside. These include two more conical baskets, two tall vases, much the same shape as the Uruk vase itself, in fact, and two small animals. The strangest objects in this group, though, are two small figures standing on pedestals, which are, in turn, set on the backs of bearded rams. The figure at the back is accompanied by Inanna's reed bundle symbol, whereas the one in front carries a flat box with a stack of what looked like bevel-rimmed bowls. And here's the most striking thing about those piles of bowls. They became a sign in the early pictographic writing system that looked exactly the same. It was read N, which meant lord or priest. It's almost as though the artist of the Uruk vase was giving us captions for his two main characters. One was Inanna, identified by her pictogram, the reed bundle, and the other was the N, Priest King, identified by his pictogram, the pile of bowls. Three more scenes adorn the Uruk vase, in registers below the one showing the N, Priest King, and Inanna. Water, in the bottom register, is represented by two wavy lines. When writing was invented, the word for water, pronounced ah, came to be expressed by two wavy lines. Above the water comes a row of plants, date palms and flax. The date palm, as you might have guessed, looks very much like the later written symbol for date palm. It's unclear whether early writers borrowed their symbols from artworks like the Uruk vase, or whether the artist of the vase was using signs already in the writing system to caption the scenes. We will come back to the writing system in the next chapter. One more level up on the Uruk vase, you find a procession of ewes and bearded rams walking toward the right. Here are the products of the land in simplified form, animals that produced meat and wool, plants that produced dates and linen. Right below the scene of the N Priest King and Inanna, a procession of identical naked men walk to the left, each carrying an offering, such as a conical basket of food or a vase. The raw materials from the animals and plants shown below have, in this register, been turned into products for the goddess to consume. The men carrying them are not only naked, they are bald and beardless. This was a sign of ritual purity, and they may represent men who were employed in the temple. The naked figure carrying the basket on the top row, between the N and Inanna, is clearly at the head of the procession of gift givers. The artist has told a story, just as though this were a picture book. Later Mesopotamian artists often did the same, using horizontal registers full of images that are to be read from the bottom to the top. It's a story about the wealth of Uruk, the authority of the N, and his nurturing relationship to the goddess, and the glory of Inanna. Other images of the N priest or priest king, a few war scenes notwithstanding, are mostly peaceful and ritualistic, as here on the Uruk vase. Perhaps this reflects that his role was not that of an oppressive tyrant, but of an organizer of the economy and the population, and an intermediary with the gods. Uruk in this era may therefore not have transcended the structures of kinship and households that bound earlier, smaller communities together. It was not run by an impersonal bureaucratic administration. The En was simply the head of the household of the goddess, and a father to his population. But Uruk was a city. Just because it doesn't match some of our modern expectations for what a city should be, it was no less extraordinary as a development. These early Urukians have told us so much about their world without, at this point, having written a word. Almost everything they did, in the end, was for Inanna and the other gods. In the next chapter, we'll discuss how things changed as writing came into wide use. Chapter 2. Colonizers, Scribes, and the Gods. When planning was underway for the Stone Cone Temple and wood had to be acquired to roof its wide hallways, it's possible that the Urukians were not dealing with foreigners when they negotiated to buy the logs. Yes, the providers of the timber lived hundreds of miles away, far to the north up the Euphrates, near the modern border between Turkey and Syria. But they may have lived in a city that would have felt just like home to someone from Uruk. They may, in fact, have lived in a colony that had been founded by southern Mesopotamians, a place now called Habuba Kabira. Its ancient name isn't known. This may sound like science fiction. How could a people without a writing system, without any form of long-distance communication except heading out in person, have come up with the idea of colonizing a distant land hundreds of miles from home? But that is just what happened, and not just at Habuba Kabira. In the first half of the 4th millennium BCE, all across the Near East, people from Uruk were not just trading with distant lands, but they were showing up in person and settling in. Uruk expansion. Habuba Kabira seems to have been an unoccupied place next to the Euphrates with no local settlement at the time the Urukians got there. What was built on that empty land was a mini Uruk, a rectangular city with an imposing and presumably effective city wall that was studded with square defensive towers. The two main gates on the east side of the city had guardhouses on both sides, so the colonists were well protected. They lived in tripartite-style houses that seemed to have packed the area inside the walls, where they ate their meals from Uruk-style pottery, received their bread or rations in beveled rim bowls, rolled their Uruk-style cylinder seals on clay bullae containing tokens, and even decorated some of the walls of public buildings with clay cone mosaics. Their city was nothing like the local settlements nearby. They were strangers there, perhaps sent specifically by the government of Uruk to set up a post on the Euphrates and to facilitate the acquisition of goods like timber and metal ores from regions further north and west. Other people from Uruk chose to settle not in new colonies, but in existing cities. During the previous millennium, the 5th millennium BCE, towns had flourished across the Near East during what is called the Ubaid period. These towns all had distinct local traditions in buildings, stamp seals, and some other objects, but they already were in contact with one another. The pottery of the Ubaid period was similar everywhere. So some of the places where Uruk colonists wanted to live were already occupied, and by people with whom they probably already had relationships. The city of Susa, to the east of Mesopotamia, in what is now western Iran, was something of a twin to Uruk. There, as in Habuba Kabira, the public buildings were adorned with vertical niches and clay cones, and archaeologists found Uruk-style cylinder seals, clay bullae with tokens, beveled rim bowls, and other Uruk-style pottery. It seems likely that some people from Uruk had crossed the marshy expanse that separated the Mesopotamian river valley from Susiana, the land around Susa, and had settled, bringing their material culture with them. But, unlike Habuba Kabira, Susa had existed for centuries before the Urukians got there, and after they left, the people of Susa returned to their local culture, and the city remained an important metropolis for millennia afterward. The Susians were enthusiastic adopters of ideas and technologies from Uruk, but only for a limited time. In other communities that were distant from southern Mesopotamia, a little enclave of Uruk colonists can be made out in the midst of a town. You can see them insisting on their familiar architecture and housewares, even their cone mosaics and cylinder seals, but surrounded by people who live differently. And in some communities, the beveled rim bowls or bullae with tokens that were found may just be the result of Uruk's powerful influence, rather than a sign of the presence of actual colonists. This explosion of Urukian culture wasn't an empire. There's no sign that the En of Uruk, the net-skirted priest-king who seems to have played such an important role there, was ruling these far-flung regions directly. It seems instead to have represented an era when the people of Uruk looked outward and set off in search of the raw materials they needed and desired, settling in areas and communities that would be useful and, ideally, not hostile to them. On the other hand, colonization was not exclusively a peaceful process, and, not surprisingly, the Urukians may have been unwelcome in some regions. In northern Syria, two cities, Tel Brak and Tel Hamukar, seem to have been attacked right before the Uruk people settled there, around 3500 BCE. The attacks, quite possibly, were by their prospective colonizers. Both cities were thriving beforehand, with city walls and a very distinctive local culture. Tel Brak, at this time, is well known for flat little stone figurines with schematic shoulders and giant eyes. They look like cartoon renditions of space aliens, though without noses or mouths, and they're called eye idols. But no one is entirely sure whether they represent gods or not. The Uruk colonists, if that is who attacked, fired clay balls over the wall at Hamukar, 1,200 small ones, and 120 more the size of softballs. Then they burned the buildings. They built their Uruk-style structures on top of the ruins. Or did they? The clay balls were pretty soft. Could they have been ready for some duller purpose, such as administration? Could the fire have had another cause? It does seem telling, though, that much of the local culture was replaced after the fire. The furthest reach of the people of Uruk seems to have been, incredibly, to Egypt. Egypt was flourishing and had already developed its own architectural and pottery styles, burial traditions, economy, and so on. This was still 1,000 years before the construction of the Great Pyramids, and the Egyptians were moving on a parallel course with the Mesopotamians toward urbanism, kingship, and writing. But during a period known as the Nakada II phase, which lasted from around 3500 to 3200 BCE, clear signs of contact with Mesopotamia began to appear in Egypt. In an ancient community at a site now called Buto, near the Mediterranean coast, colored clay cones in red, black, and white were apparently used to make mosaics. They could have obtained these by trade. There's not much else in northern Egypt to suggest contact with Uruk. But further south, along the Nile, the connections are clear. People in several towns adopted cylinder seals, using imported ones from Mesopotamia, or making their own. They began building with mud bricks, which had not previously been a tradition in Egypt, and using them to create Mesopotamian-looking monumental buildings with lines of vertical niches. The classic facade of an Egyptian palace retained these niches for centuries. Some Egyptian artisans even incorporated Mesopotamian motifs into artworks. A man flanked by two rearing animals, for example, or a high-prowed Mesopotamian boat. No Uruk colony has been found among the Egyptian sites, but it does seem likely that Urukians were living there somewhere, if temporarily, as they did in other cities across the Near East. A fascinating, but perhaps unlikely theory, is that people from Uruk sailed their high-prowed boats south down the Euphrates, continuing through the Persian Gulf and right around Arabia, then north along the Red Sea, disembarking somewhere on its western shores and trekking across the desert to Upper Egypt. This is an almost incomprehensibly long and difficult sea journey for such an early period, but it would at least explain how Uruk period objects wound up in the Nile River Valley while leaving the northern part of Egypt unaffected, other than those few clay cones from Buto. Perhaps it is more likely that the influence on Egypt came through western Syria rather than directly from Uruk. In this scenario, Urukian goods from Habuba Kabira passed westward to the Syrian coast, were traded south through the Levant, the lands that border the eastern shores of the Mediterranean, to Egypt, and from there up the Nile. No matter how it happened or what exact form these various colonies and communities took, the people of Uruk had a tremendous impact on people living all across the Near East and into Egypt during the same few centuries that their hometown was growing into an impressive city. The Eanna in later centuries. At the beginning of level 4 at Uruk, many new monumental buildings were constructed in the sacred precinct of the Eanna in the heart of the city. By now, the complex was immense. It covered about 9 hectares. To give you a sense of scale, that is an area about 3 times larger than the much later Acropolis in Athens. The buildings in the Temenos area were designated by the excavators as Building A, Building B, Building C, and so on, but it's unclear which were temples, which, if any, were palaces, which, if any, were open to the public, and which were private, just for priests and officials. At this point, around 3300 BCE, a visitor might have approached the new structures by walking past the brick tomb that incorporated the ruins of the stone cone temple. Many of the buildings featured crisp buttresses, separated by niches, that created the same striped exterior appearance as the wall around the earlier stone cone temple. These types of buttresses were a distinctive feature of Mesopotamian temple architecture for centuries to come. Everything was now built of mud brick. There was not a concrete wall or a stone cone to be found. A visitor might have been struck by how accessible it all seemed. There were, for example, three or more doorways on each of the long sides of every building, and once you ventured inside a building, into the shady interior, multiple doorways allowed entry into the main hallway, one from each of the side rooms. The builders don't seem to have been preoccupied with defending the structures. Although the temple precinct as a whole was walled, within it, people could move easily between one building and another, and there were many entry points to the heart of each structure. Unlike later Mesopotamian temples, each of which had a holy shrine, usually accessed by just one door and open to only a few high-ranking priests and priestesses, the Ayana buildings, including whichever one was the main temple, seem to have been open and inviting. Many of them were decorated with the same type of cone mosaics first created in the stone cone temple, but the builders had found they could create the same dazzling visual effect which had previously been achieved with stone cones by using baked clay cones with painted ends. These, sadly, have faded over the millennia and don't retain the vivid colors of the stone cones or the glazed cones of the stone cone temple. In one courtyard area, a row of large columns with no spaces between them each had a different mosaic design, alternating big diamonds, then zigzag lines, then small triangles, back to big diamonds, and so on. The effect would have been almost dizzying. The entire complex was beautifully designed. Nothing about it was slipshod or incomplete. Details had been considered carefully and executed with masterly artistry. The complex was an appropriately spectacular home for Inanna, and she continued to live there for thousands of years. Beginning of writing. As the level 4 buildings rose, and their halls filled with priests, priestesses, artisans, workers, and administrators, all the work of running the Ayana must have become a growing headache for those in charge. The people who worked for the temple and its estates had to be provided with payment or rations, and any number of administrative details had to be committed to memory. The amounts of crops produced by the fields, the numbers of animals in the herds, the quantities of goods to be presented to the goddess, and countless other details. At some point, someone in power came up with a system to help keep track of things. Clay tablets used for this system were found in Uruk, within the Ayana, discarded in trash heaps after they were no longer useful. With the benefit of hindsight, we moderns herald these clay tablets as representing the first writing, and the tablets found in the Ayana do indeed seem to have been the earliest in the Near East. It seems like a great leap forward. People were beginning to commit words to written form. But the truth is that this early system had little in common with what writing later became. It did not, in fact, represent an attempt to record language, nor was it a system used to express ideas. The signs did not even appear in the order in which words were spoken. They had more in common with clay tokens and bullae than with modern writing. The system the Uruk people created has been dubbed proto-cuneiform, because the later script is known as cuneiform. But the people who developed it had no idea that their innovation was proto-anything, that it would develop further in the future. It was simply a useful tool that one could use to keep track of commodities, and it worked fine. The date when those first proto-cuneiform tablets were written is unclear. We only know that they were thrown away as useless trash at a time when the stone cone temple was no longer in use, but the later Ayana temples were thriving. Scholars have suggested that the first ones might have been written as early as 3500 BCE or as late as 3200 BCE, though the latter seems too late given the level in which they were found. Whatever the date, the new system for recording administrative details met a pressing need. In an influential book published in 1992, Denise Schmant-Besserat, a professor at the University of Texas at Austin, proposed that the tokens and clay balls of earlier periods were precursors to writing, that administrators had moved from placing clay tokens inside bullae first to creating the same record by pressing the clay tokens on a clay lump without it having to be hollow, and next to pressing the end of a stylus onto clay to indicate numbers and drawing pictures, sometimes pictures of the tokens, with a sharp point, to indicate nouns. It's an ingenious theory that has influenced scholars in this field for decades. Archaeologists working at the site of Tel Sabi Abiyat, far from Uruk in North Syria, have found tokens used as some kind of counting device as early as 6000 BCE, though they didn't see any sign of them evolving or increasing over time. What is clear is that by the early Uruk period, the way administrators thought about numbers and commodities when using tokens was very similar to the way they thought about numbers and commodities when using proto-cuneiform. Neither system really had anything to do with language. On the earliest proto-cuneiform tablets, the administrators included numerical signs impressed with a stylus, in various shapes, with no indication of what was being counted. After a while, they began to divide up the surface of the clay tablet with incised lines and to add pictograms to identify commodities. Each box on the front of the tablet, the obverse, usually contained a number and a picture. Some of these were little sketches of the thing being tracked, a fish, a stalk of grain, or a pot, for example. And some reproduced the shape of a token that had been used for a commodity, such as a circle with a cross on it, to represent sheep. Signs sometimes also indicated the profession or name of a person, perhaps the one receiving the things listed. The back of the tablet usually featured nothing more than the sum total of the goods shown on the front. The vast majority of proto-cuneiform tablets found in the debris at Uruk comprised administrative lists of goods and people, lists that were produced during the day-to-day running of the temples. Most recorded a single set of transactions, and a few combined information from several of the smaller tablets into a larger ledger. The tablets aren't completely deciphered yet, but it's clear that the mechanisms of the administration were already quite sophisticated. The goods listed can tell us quite a bit about life in the temple storerooms, and more broadly, in the city of Uruk during this period. Not surprisingly, wheat and barley are mentioned a great deal, and a lot of it was distributed as rations for workers employed by the temple. The ration system took a person's status into consideration. Supervisors received more than ordinary male workers, who in turn received more than women. The temple also dealt with dairy products and with meat. Higher-ranking individuals again got preferred treatment in distributions of meat, which seems to have been provided for feasts. A striking revelation from these apparently dull lists is just how centralized the economy seems to have been at such an early time. The temple employed and provided for a great many people and must have had a lot of food stored in granaries and warehouses. Not all of the tablets pertained to food and animals, though. Many others recorded the production of textiles made of wool. Each of 15 different types of sheep was identified with its own pictogram, including one that was specified to be the wool sheep. Over time, as you will hear in later chapters, cloth became one of the most important exports from Mesopotamia. Already, right at the beginning of urban culture, its production was at least partly controlled by the temples, and it was essential to the Mesopotamian economy. Prior to the Uruk period, linen seems to have been more commonly used as a fabric, but it was more labor-intensive to make than wool, and it was made from flax plants that had to be grown in fields that could otherwise have produced food. Sheep, in contrast, could graze in lands that weren't at all suitable for agriculture. So once some types of sheep had been bred to produce wool that could be spun and woven, cloth production switched overwhelmingly to wool. Fortunately for us, all of this production was being tracked by officials, using clay tablets impressed with proto-cuneiform pictograms and number signs. Without them, we would know little about the remarkable mechanisms that had been created to make everything work smoothly. Who were the people of Uruk? A pictogram can be read in any language, so it's impossible to be sure of the language spoken by the users of proto-cuneiform. Over the centuries that the signs were in use, the pictograms gradually became less like drawings. The reed stylus that they used in order to write had a tip much like the square end of a modern mass-produced wooden chopstick. If you press the edge of the square end into clay, it makes a sharp line with a little triangle at the top. And if you press the corner into the clay, it just makes the triangle. Hurried scribes found that they could make the shapes of the pictograms out of straight lines and triangles by pressing the stylus into the clay in this way. At some point, the signs, each made of combinations of lines and triangles, were no longer recognizable as anything at all. They were no longer pictograms. The thing that strikes a viewer most about these more developed signs is the omnipresence of the triangle shapes. They give the script a rather extravagant look, like a medieval manuscript on steroids. There seem to be triangles everywhere. But they were not unnecessary curlicues. They were all needed in order for signs to be distinguished from one another. In the late 17th century of our era, a German physician and world traveler named Engelbert Kämpfer spent time in Persia and produced a beautiful copy of an example of this wedge-shaped writing, though one written long after the Uruk period. The script wasn't deciphered in his lifetime, so he never knew what it recorded, but he came up with a name for it, cuneiform, because cuneus means wedge in Latin. The term stuck. The users of proto-cuneiform seem to have managed well with their system, even though it was very limited in its range of expressions. Number, noun, person. Number, noun, person. Number, noun, person, total, person responsible. This was enough to relieve the administrator of the burden of memorizing innumerable details and of making vast numbers of tokens and clay balls. There were a few words that they needed to record, though, that were not nouns. One was the verb to return, but there's no obvious way to draw return. For this, the administrators ingeniously began to use the sign that meant read. And once they did this, we can detect the language hiding behind the script. This tiny detail tells us that they were thinking and speaking in the language known as Sumerian, because the word for a reed in Sumerian was gi, and that was also the word for to return. They used the sign for the sound of the word here, not the meaning of the picture, and this marked the start of writing words phonetically. Later written documents revealed that Sumerian was the native tongue of most people in Uruk and throughout southern Mesopotamia, the area they called Sumer, during the late 4th millennium BCE and through most of the 3rd. It continued to be the language of religion and learning long after that. Sumerian was considered to be a singularly prestigious and important language for thousands of years. Sadly, though, it left no descendants and is unrelated to any modern language. In the proto-cuneiform system, writers used a huge number of individual signs, around 1,500. About a third of these have been found only once on any of the tablets, which means that these signs were used very, very rarely, because about 6,000 tablets are known. It's possible that these singleton signs may have been made up on the spot by an official needing to record some obscure commodity. But about 100 of the signs were in frequent use, each showing up more than 100 times. And another 370 signs appear between 11 and 100 times. So although some signs seem to have been invented somewhat spontaneously, it's clear that many signs formed a shared system, and that the writers had learned these ones so that they could communicate with other people. The signs that recorded numbers were also consistent, remarkably so. They were ordered in complicated numerical systems. We will come back to Mesopotamian mathematics in a later chapter, but for now, you should know that it was based on the number 60 and is therefore referred to as a sexagesimal system. The main units were at what we would designate 1, 10, 60, 360, 60 times 6, 3,600, 60 times 60, and 36,000, 60 times 60 times 10. A separate numerical sign existed for each of these numbers. This sounds confusing, but we still use it in a way. There are 360 degrees in a circle, 60 seconds in a minute, and 60 minutes in an hour, because the Mesopotamians came up with this system, and in a long and convoluted way, we inherited it. The sexagesimal system works particularly well for fractions. The number 60 can be divided evenly by 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. And since the Mesopotamians dealt with commodities in large numbers, fractions were in constant use, and no decimal points were needed, which was good because they hadn't invented them. The weird thing is that in proto-cuneiform, the sexagesimal system was used for keeping track of some things, but not for everything. Some other items were counted using a bisexagesimal system, with the units at 1, 10, 60, 120, 60 times 2, 1,200, 60 times 2 times 10, and 7,200, 60 times 2 times 60, again with separate signs for each. It got even more complicated because different signs were used depending on what type of countable object was being counted, so that 13 different systems of counting goods and people were in use at the same time. Cushim, controller of the barley warehouse. The people whose names appear in the proto-cuneiform tablets from Uruk are a little like the everyday people who posed for some of the earliest photographs thousands of years later. Suddenly, there they are, fellow humans, named. but the mark they have left on history is almost vanishingly faint. We can't even be sure how to pronounce their names, but their appearance on the clay tablets testifies to the fact that they were real people who lived more than 5,000 years ago, that they were as real as you and I are, and that they were the first named individuals in history. One such man seems to have been named Cushim, at least that's how the signs in his name would have been read later on, when Sumerian was definitely the language being represented. Scholars were able to reconstruct some details of Cushim's professional activities and to analyze the tablets he drew up. He was a high-ranking temple administrator, with the official title Sangha, who worked in the Ayana complex around 3000 BCE. We don't know which building housed the rooms where he worked, but one can imagine him, at home in that immense complex, talking with other officials, counting jars of goods, writing and sealing tablets, and thinking through how he could get his deliveries completed. 18 of the proto-cuneiform tablets found at Uruk were signed by him, that is, his name appears at the end, and tell us a little of what occupied his days. Cushim had a role in the distribution of ingredients for an all-important item of the Mesopotamian diet, beer. Specifically, he oversaw a warehouse and kept track of the malt and cracked barley that were kept there. Large deliveries came and went on a regular basis and had to be recorded, and almost all the grain in his domain was destined to become beer, which was essential to life in the Mesopotamian view. His tablets show that beer was not just brewed at home by farmers, it was produced by the temple and was integral to the city's economy. Beer had been brewed and drunk in the Near East long before scribes began writing about it, possibly as early as the Neolithic. Fermentation made beer safe to drink, free from the germs and impurities that could infest river water, and the alcohol content of most beers, though not all, seems to have been lower than today. People drank beer a lot. As in colonial America and in many other places and times, low-alcohol beer was safe to drink and considered to be an important part of a meal. It's possible that some Near Eastern beers had no alcohol content at all, though some types were certainly associated with drunkenness, as plenty of later tales confirm. We know from images on early cylinder seals that a favorite social event involved arranging chairs around a big pot of beer, gathering friends or family members together, and drinking it through long straws. Cushim might well have done this himself, though presumably not when he was working. Their beer must have tasted very different from its modern equivalents because it was brewed without hops, but with a number of aromatic herbs and sometimes date syrup. Charged with keeping track of the vital ingredients in his warehouse, Cushim carefully wrote lists of the amounts of cracked barley and malt that were being distributed to particular individuals. Sometimes these amounts were vast. One tablet refers to a delivery of 135,000 liters of barley. Another, written by a scribe who worked for Cushim, detailed the ingredients that were needed for 8 different types of beer and for 9 other products made of cereals. In this tablet alone, the scribe used 5 of the different number systems. Cushim's job extended to the distribution of finished beer as well. One tablet notes that his office delivered 35 jars of beer, of 3 different types, to a single person. Cushim did have an Achilles heel, though. He was a powerful man, but he wasn't necessarily at his best when it came to mathematics. He made quite a few mistakes in the totals that he recorded on his tablets. Cushim, along with other administrators and scribes, must have been educated. His mathematical mistakes notwithstanding, he had learned to add, subtract, divide, and multiply, presumably in all 13 of the different numerical systems. He had also learned to copy and memorize the hundreds of commonly used pictographic signs and numerals, and to create records that could be understood by others. This would have taken a lot to pick up on the job, so schools almost certainly existed to prepare aspiring administrators for their work. The schools might, in fact, have been the institutions that had systematized the script and decided on the signs that would be used in the first place. Luckily for us, the very few tablets that weren't written in service of the administration seem to have been products of these schools, and they provide some clues about the curriculum. They show that students had to write and memorize long lists of the nouns they would need during their careers. These are known as lexical lists. One of these tablets was found in level 4 of the Ayana temple complex and featured a list of professions. It's small, just 8.7 by 6.1 centimeters in size, but was divided into 4 vertical columns on each side, with 9 or 10 boxes per column, and each box included the number 1, followed by the sign for an occupation. These are listed in hierarchical order, from the most important functionaries to the least. At the top, where you might have expected to find the En, the most powerful man in Uruk, is instead the Nemeshta, who seems to have been the top-ranked official. Curiously, the title of N doesn't appear. Perhaps his exalted role was in a different category entirely from those of temple officers. It's unclear, though. The term Nemeshta was later equated to the word for king, so it could already have been one of the N's titles. This is far from the only known copy of this list of professions, but it is the earliest. Scribes in schools continued to copy the standard list of professions for hundreds of years after this, long after most of the professions they had to memorize were completely obsolete. Schooling, like many things in the ancient Near East, was marked by a deep conservatism, or at least this was the case after the explosion of new ideas and institutions that occurred during the Uruk period. The same was true of the accounting system, which seems to have appeared in Uruk, almost fully realized, during levels 4 and 3. For thousands of years after this, scribes kept on performing the same routine. They recorded exact amounts of goods in a particular consignment, along with the name of the person they would be delivered to or were being received from, and, later, the use to which they would be put. Then they totaled them up, sealed the tablet, and sometimes dated it. Groups of small tablets like this were stored together. Periodically, scribes transferred the information from the small tablets to big ledgers, which were then archived. Admittedly, not everything stayed the same as in the Uruk period. In later centuries, most of the Byzantine numerical schemes were simplified, so that the same number signs could be used for many different weights and measures and many different goods, and the number of cuneiform signs in regular use dropped to around 600, following a fairly quick abandonment of all the eccentric one-use-only signs. But the basic system invented by the Ayana administrators was sound. It provided Mesopotamia with the foundation for an economic system that functioned effectively for a very long time. I should add that most subsequent administrators did better than Kushim in adding up quantities of goods. The fields of the N. The earliest tablets from level 4 at Uruk have no parallels elsewhere. But tablets like the one from level 3, which started to be written around 3100 BCE, the ones with numbers, commodities, and possible names, have shown up at a number of ancient cities, including places hundreds of miles from Uruk. One late Uruk period tablet from a site called Jemdet Nasser has been singled out in particular as among the most important documents in all of Mesopotamian history. It's not exactly a literary masterpiece, though. It's a list of fields, and for each field, the scribe provided its dimensions, the length, the width, the perimeter, or the area of the field, along with the profession of the person who controlled it. They were all important officials. At the end, of course, is a total of all the land listed. The first five fields listed were rectangular, of about the same large size, and three times as long as they were wide. Throughout Mesopotamian history, fields were generally long and narrow. The landscape seems to have been divided up pretty regularly, even at this remarkably early date. A centralized authority hides behind this fact. The division of the land was not organic or arbitrary. But this isn't the main reason for the tablet's importance. Those first five fields, between them, make up only one-third of the allocated land. The other two-thirds of the land are listed in a separate box, and the cuneiform sign used to identify their owner is the one that looks like a tray holding a pile of beveled-rimmed bowls, the sign for Lord, the N. This was our friend the priest king, the man who, in Uruk, was so closely associated with the goddess Inanna. In Jemdet Nasser, we see that the man in the same role controlled 10 times as much land as any of the first five individuals. The tablet provides some of the earliest proof of power and wealth being consolidated by one man, the N, in each city, and of the dramatic social stratification that was a feature of the new urban world of the Uruk period. It's also interesting to note that among the recipients of the other fields, who included men with the titles Chief Exchange Agent, Equid Herder, Chief Justice, and Priest, was Wife of the N. Queens played a major role in Mesopotamian history, as you will hear in future chapters. Although the Wife of the N seems to have controlled only a tenth of the land of her husband, she was clearly an important figure. A whole lot of developments have been taking place in Uruk and other cities in Mesopotamia in the years leading up to 3100 BCE. We've already discussed their advances in monumental architecture, organization and provisioning of workers, management of the economy, division of the landscape, development of a writing system, use of the wheel and of the pottery wheel, creation of cylinder seals to identify individuals or offices, imports of large amounts of raw materials from distant lands, and development of an artistic style with figures shown in registers, as on the Uruk vase. We've also seen changes in society, such as an increased separation between rich and poor, and consolidation of power by the N priest king. But there were even more innovations. The plow was in wide use. It's pictured on cylinder seals. Metalworking had become more sophisticated. Objects of gold, silver, and especially copper have been found in the Uruk period levels at a number of sites. Metalworkers were casting utensils, tools, vessels, jewelry, and statuettes. To see so many changes in a relatively short time is extraordinary, given the slow pace of change in culture before the Uruk period, and, surprisingly, after it as well. There's a reason that the focal point of much of this activity was the Eanna temple complex. Many of the innovations at Uruk, probably most of them, were in the service of the goddess Inanna. How they understood their world and their deities. On the surface, life in Uruk was surprisingly similar to life today. The buildings of the Eanna would be impressive even to modern visitors if we could have visited them in their original condition. We, too, recognize the impulse to make a glorious space for the divine, a temple, church, or mosque, for example. We share a surprising number of other life experiences with people who lived in Uruk 5,500 years ago. We have inherited many of the same institutions, farming, trade, marriage, and taxation, for example. Like us, people in the Uruk period lived in rectangular houses that opened onto streets. Although houses haven't been excavated at Uruk itself, we know from other Mesopotamian cities of the same period that their houses had rooms, furniture, doors, and windows, though without glass, which had not yet been invented. They cooked their meals in ovens and ate from pottery bowls. Their diet was based on bread, fish, vegetables, they loved onions and garlic, fruits, and some meat, beef, pork, lamb, goat. They drank beer. They wore clothes made of wool and linen. Sometimes their community, as a whole, got into a dispute with another one, and sometimes these disputes led to warfare. In all these ways, life hasn't changed dramatically from earliest times. I suspect that it will change a great deal more in future, and that ancient history will come to be seen as everything up to about the beginning of the 18th century CE, when technology began to leap forward. On the other hand, the ancient Near Eastern conception of the universe was completely different from ours. They would not have understood how we think, and it's very difficult for us to understand them. Partly, this is because modern science has provided us with an explanation for almost every natural phenomenon. But there's more to it than that. How the Mesopotamians explained their world is usually termed their religion, but most modern religions are so different from ancient ones that we need to shed our preconceptions about religion in order to try to grasp their conceptions of the divine. Some of what they experienced in life was predictable, even beautiful, in its regularity and orderliness, such as the way the sun rose without fail every morning, the way the moon waxed and waned without fail every 29 and a half days, the way the seasons reliably shifted through the year, the way the rivers provided an endless source of fresh water to sustain crops. On the other hand, the people of Mesopotamia during the Uruk period, actually the people of the whole Near East throughout ancient history, were confronted with any number of inexplicable phenomena, many of which could cause them immense grief and loss. Flood damage, dust storms, epidemics, crop diseases, swarms of locusts, earthquakes, droughts. Humans did nothing to bring these on. How could they be explained? How could they be prevented? In every family, loved ones got ill and died, sometimes in infancy, sometimes in old age, or at any time in between. Why? The answer to all these questions was so obvious to them that it didn't need a book or a creed to explain it. The peoples of the ancient Near East didn't even have a word for religion. The source of all these phenomena was as much a part of the observable world as was a tree or a river. Think of it this way. People could see causes and effects in the things they themselves did every day. A human could plant crops in a field, tear down a house, or eat a meal. The outcomes of these actions were obvious. Plants grew, walls fell, hunger was satiated. So something or someone must be causing the phenomena that humans didn't control, and it was clear that this someone, or someones, lived longer than any human and had vastly more power. It was also clear to the people that there were many of these powerful beings. The one that provided water for their crops was not the same one that caused the sun to rise in the eastern sky every morning, and so on. These powerful beings were real, and they were everywhere. They also seemed to have human characteristics, love, anger, generosity. And at some point before the Uruk period, they had been anthropomorphized and imagined to be human in temperament, and even in appearance. To a Mesopotamian, family was all important, as was respect for hierarchy. Parents cared for their children, children obeyed and respected their parents. Siblings watched out for one another and could be relied upon to be there when needed. A workplace emulated a family, with the supervisor as the father. So, later, did a state, but with the king as the father. It's not surprising, then, that gods and goddesses, because that is what the powerful beings obviously were, had families, husbands, wives, and children, and that some had more clout than others. It was the gods' universe, and humans represented nothing more than a cosmic afterthought, far down in the hierarchy, as slaves to the immortals. The gods and goddesses had created the universe for themselves. Humans could enjoy its gifts, taking advantage of the food, water, and raw materials available to them, but their lives were subject to the whims of their unseen masters. And when these masters decided to unleash erratic storms of chaos from time to time...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.